This is John Cola with Growing Your Greens, and I have a special announcement for you guys. Until May 25th at midnight, I'm offering some t-shirts for you guys. Growing Your Greens official t-shirts, limited time only. I don't know if they'll ever be back again because I'm not in the business of selling t-shirts. I'm here to teach you guys about how to grow your own food. But anyways, you could help me out so that I could buy a farm with my girlfriend and you guys get a t-shirt at the same time. 100% recycled, 100% made in America. They fit me great, that's why I selected them. I've had the same brand t-shirts for over 2 years now, and they wear really well and wash really well and don't rip and all this other kind of stuff. They hold up really well. That's why I'm offering them. Click over right here to get yours today. All right, this is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and I'm here in my greenhouse today, and behind me is my garden that's getting rained on. So it's been raining. I was starting to make the video outside, but it was getting rained out, so couldn't do it. But anyways, instead of overlooking my lettuce bed, my peppers are just recently planted. You guys are overlooking my tomatoes that are already planted out, as well as my leafy greens behind me. I don't know if you guys can see some of the arugula over there. And then I got, back over on that side, you guys can see I planted out okra. So today's episode actually is what we're gonna do is we're gonna go ahead and answer your guys' questions. And I apologize in advance, I get questions underneath this video, underneath other videos, and a lot of different ways. And I apologize, it's my policy not to answer people's questions that email me or, you know, message me individually. And I have to do this because I have to have a life. I have a girlfriend, I have a garden, I have a lot of things I have to take care of in my life, and I can't just sit there and answer questions all day as much as I would like to. And so I apologize in advance for that. You know, I know there's a lot of my helpful viewers that do read the questions and that will post answers, because I know a lot of you guys can help out others because you guys know a lot of stuff, so that's great. I just don't have the time, so what I do is I will make videos like this and take some select questions and answer them for you guys so you guys could hear my answers. Now, if you want to submit a question for this video format, you can do so over the discussion tabs. If you go to growingyourgreens.com, there's a discussion tab. Click that, you can post a question there, or you could click the about, and then there's a place to send me a message through the YouTube messaging system. And then it'll appear in an episode like this if I select your question. And then the other way to ask me a question is to contact me over the phone, or I'll actually give you a call for 10 minutes for just $5. Of that, I get $4, and of that, I keep zero. All the money goes back into the Fiverr community to help get my videos transcribed so that people that are hearing impaired or people that don't speak English can get English transcriptions, which then YouTube will convert into other languages to make my content available to people around the world. This is something very important to me, to so that everybody has access to have the knowledge to grow their own food if they so choose to, right? And we're not given this knowledge, and especially the knowledge that I share on how to grow the highest quality food. You know, that's super important to me and super important to the planet, to the health of the plants on the planet, and to our health in the end. So check the link down below to my Fiverr campaign to talk to me to answer your questions if you're interested in that. Anyways, on with today's video. And the paper got kind of like too wet, so I actually had to put on a little saucer for my pot. So first question is from Wolfory Firebeard. Hello John, I live in Southern California in the high desert. We are in a drought. Am looking for ways to conserve water before I start planting anything. I was curious what your thoughts are on using the hydrogel in diapers for mixing into the soil to help retain water. I've seen a few videos on this and it seems to me that it might work, but I was wondering what your thoughts were. Alright, so yeah, they have different, you know, whether you want to use the hydrogel in diapers, I don't know that I'd use that. They actually have products actually to add into soil to do the same thing. They're basically polymers that hold water like a sponge and then release water as needed. You know, there's pros and cons to all this new technology to actually put it into the garden, put it into the soil, and to get you guys growing. I mean, I think number one, before I use hydrogel in soil, you know, I might look into something kind of like an aquaponics system, maybe even a hydroponic system that recirculates the water That's probably going to save some water, provided you actually, you know, don't just dump the water when you're done with it. If you're in a hydro system after you have it all full of synthetic fertilizers. Another way I would just use nature's methods of holding water and conserving water. So before I would use a hydrogel product, which depending on the situation I'm like, I live in a desert environment and I don't use any hydrogel. I use organic matter. Organic matter is like a sponge. It'll hold the water and also release it. Maybe not as well or as long as a hydrogel product, but it will do that. So I add things in like the coconut coir that acts like a sponge that will hold the water and release the water as needed so I could water less frequently. Another thing I might use, maybe not as good as the coconut coir, but also readily available most places, is the peat moss. So you could use that also, and those are two alternatives I would use before using the plastic polymers in the dirt. Another thing that's very important that you might want to do is mulch. This is critically important. You know, why have the dirt hold the water better? Why not just keep the sun off the dirt so that it doesn't evaporate off? So you could get a reflective mulch. This is probably one of the best mulches out there. Plastic reflective mulch to reflect the light off the soil so that it doesn't get hot, so that the water doesn't evaporate off. And once the water is underneath the soil, you know, it's not really going to go anywhere but down. And hopefully if you're watering appropriately and have enough organic matter, it's going to hold enough water in there, you know, and you won't need the plastic beads or, you know, the plastic polymers that are a new invention. And, you know, in the right application, it may be good. And, you know, I encourage you guys to experiment with different methods of growing. You know, I always think that if you're growing your method, even if you're using plastic polymers in your soil, you know, and you're growing your own food, that's definitely better than buying the conventional or, you know, even organic food that's trucked in from thousands of miles away. All right, next question is from Lloyd Campbell. John, I'm building a raised bed garden. After watching your video series on building raised bed garden, it looks like you were using straight compost to fill the bed. Do you add any soil to the compost? Can you tell me what soil mix you use? So Lloyd, in different parts of my gardening career, if you want to call it a career, I use different things. So originally, you know, I use straight compost from the local compost facility. That's a not currently selling compost anymore, unfortunately, Sonoma compost. And I added things like rock dust. I think those are the main two things I added way back then. I didn't even add any kind of worm castings or anything like that. And things grew great. Now, I don't necessarily recommend this for you guys out there because, you know, I know the compost I was getting from Sonoma compost was good to grow in straight. Many composts you may buy may not be good to grow in straight. You know, it may not be finished enough, you know, and has too much woody chips and pulp in there. Or it may be from a manure source and be too hot and may burn your plants, you know. I'm not there to look at the compost. I'm not there to look at the specs or the paperwork on the compost. So I want to recommend you guys don't do that, actually, even though I did it and it did work. You know, here in this garden, I did not grow in straight compost. The compost that I got at the time I started this side of the yard was just way too woody and wasn't a good finished compost, in my opinion. So I added and did what's called the Mel Bartholomew raised bed mixture. And that's a 1/3 compost, 1/3 coconut coir or peat moss, and 1/3 vermiculite. And that's what I use in this side. You know, and after doing that, things grew all right, but it still didn't grow as well as, you know, when I used 100% compost when I was able to get the Sonoma compost. And so I kind of chalked that up to, like, you know, the compost that I did get, the 1/3 mixture, maybe wasn't that good quality. So what I would recommend in my modified kind of mixture nowadays is I would recommend 50% good high quality compost that's really nice, dark, rich, and black and broken down well. You don't see a lot of, you know, wood chips and pieces in there, although some are acceptable. Then I would use like maybe like 20%, you know, the coconut coir and 20% vermiculite. And then also I would use like 10%. The rest would be things like the rock dust, the zeolite, the worm castings, insect frass, and some of the other things I use, you know, in much smaller amounts. And I think that'd be a good standard mixture, right? And you could add all kinds of other things in there. You know, lately I have perlite, so I put perlite in my mixture and stuff, but I'd start off with the basics, you know, and if you start off with something that works, and Mel Bartholomew, hats off to him. He had and played a good role in my motivation to get me back into gardening and growing food. And that's what I'd recommend. You know, sometimes the vermiculite and the coconut coir can get expensive, and it's very important if you are getting coconut coir to get a good brand. You know, I do recommend the Wonder Soil brand coconut coir, because a lot of the coconut coirs out there may have too high levels of salts in there, and then you won't get good growth results. And I think that also may have been a challenge for me on this side. I didn't use maybe the best brand of coconut coir at the time. I just used a brand that I could find and that was cheap and available. And that's not always the best thing to do, as I learned. All right, next question is from Samantha Boaz. Hello, John. I made the worst mistake while I was in a hurry and sprayed all my blue potatoes with bleach instead of water. I quickly dug them out about 10 seconds after and rinsed them, tossed the soil, rinsed the burlap bags they were in, and planted them again. They aren't plants yet because I just planted them about 3 days ago, but they did have roots. I'm afraid I just totally killed my little spuds. My question is, will they live? That's a good question. I have no idea. But here's the thing. I mean, if you sprayed bleach and it lasted 10 seconds and you're spraying it on top of the soil and not directly on the spuds, you know, the bleach probably got in the soil, and I don't know how you would dump so much bleach that it would go through the soil and really hit the spuds. That being said, also, plants and we are resilient. I remember one time I was filling my Jeep Wrangler with the gas at the gas station, actually. And the way it goes in, it kind of like fell out. So the gas thing, like the spout came out on me and it was spilling gas all over me. And I'm like, crap. And I felt it go into me instantly. Because it's like, man, our skin is permeable, although we think it's like impermeable. Especially things like petroleum distillates and products and MTBE and all this. And I felt it go in me. And then before I could do anything, the station attendant came over and sprayed more crap. Toxic chemicals on me because I spilled gas on myself, and I'm like, oh my god, more toxic chemicals. And that stuff did go inside me. I mean, I'm alright, I'm still living and stuff. All of my body is detoxed from all that stuff back then. But I personally believe your spuds will be fine, and probably the best thing to do is to not worry about it, right? Not worry about it and hedge your bets, right? I'm not a betting guy, but hedge your bets. You know, plant those, give them the best care, make sure you don't overwater them too much. You already did wash them off. Get another set of blue potatoes and plant a new set of blue potatoes next to the set that got the bleach on them, right? And see what happens. And have fun. That's the most important thing when gardening. Have fun. And, you know, yeah, I lose plants. You know, I lose plants sometimes. I'm going to have a future video where I show, you know, I planted 88 peppers in my bed and four of them didn't make it, and I think I know why. But, you know, big deal. Pull them out, plant some more. All right, chalk it up to a learning experience. So next time, I bet you will never spray bleach on your plants again. And if you're all my other viewers that are not Samantha, pay attention when you're watering your plants and don't spray them with bleach or other toxins, please. So I won't have to get any more questions like this. All right, anyways, next question. Eat for Jesus, Rick. Can sunflower seeds meant for birds be used for sprouts meant for people? All right, so can they be used? Yes, they can be used. I do know many of my friends, and actually I have done that in the past, where I buy, you know, black oil seed sunflower seeds that are meant for bird seed use, and say for bird use only on the package, and then I grow them into the sunflower sprouts that I grow and then eat myself. I haven't had any issues with this, but once again, you know, these are non-organic seeds meant for bird food. They probably put that disclaimer on there because otherwise if people started buying those and eating them, you know, then the people growing the real sunflower seeds for people wouldn't probably make any money. I don't really know. I would also encourage you to check the labels and make sure they're not sprayed or coated with oil or any other kind of preservatives. Make sure they're 100% black oil sunflower seeds. And of course, you know, those are conventional raised seeds. Obviously, they can't have too many pesticides or anything on them because the birds you're feeding would croak or something. So they can be too bad, but nonetheless, I do encourage you guys whenever possible to grow and buy organic seeds. Now, it can be difficult to find the organic black oil sunflower seeds, but it is possible. I would recommend a place like gotsprouts.com. You know, I'm sure they have them there. The other thing I would recommend to you guys is go out and get some black oil sunflower seeds that are non-organic and plant them in your garden, in all around your border, all around your fence line, about, you know, one every foot. And you'll have these beautiful sunflowers all on your fence line. You could use some for cut flowers. But then at the end of the season, you could harvest all the seeds from all your sunflowers all the way down the row and have truly organic black oil sunflower seeds that you could then grow, you know, into the sprouts for eating. And then just repeat that each and every year instead of being dependent on buying your black oil sunflower seeds to grow and sprout all the time. All right, next question is from Lynette Cox. What kind of mix do I need for good vegetable growing soil in containers? I have access to alpaca, horse, cow manure, and mushroom soil. What can I use? I plan to plant in white half barrels. Should they be painted darker? Where in Pennsylvania? How deep should a raised bed be? Do you have any rattlesnakes? Also, any new programs coming out? Thanks, and love to watch you on YouTube, Lynette. All right, Lynette, so you got a number of questions there. First question is, what kind of soil do you need for growing in containers? So if you're growing in containers, I do recommend a potting soil in containers. You know, I like to have my container mixture kind of like, you know, have kind of more aeration and drainage, because in general they won't get, you know, earthworms and things in there, although you could put earthworms in a wine barrel. So I recommend using a potting soil mixture, and if you don't want to buy a potting soil mixture, kind of like make up your own potting soil mixture, and you could go to a nursery and see what ingredients they put in a potting soil and then use those ingredients in your mixture. So that's what I'd recommend. It'd be similar to like a raised bed mixture, but they don't even fluff it up more by putting in some extra perlite in there in addition to the vermiculite, and maybe a little bit more coconut coir, you know, to help the water retention. Let's see, I would use a plant-based compost. That's what I personally like to use. You could probably get away with using a finely composted, you know, manure. I wouldn't use straight manure in your blend. Once again, I like to blend things up, so I'd use, you know, maybe like 10% of a, you know, manure, and make sure that you know where the manure is coming from and that what the animals are eating, and they're not being fed GMO corn and soy and antibiotics and eating all these other things, like they could be eating, you know, plants grown with different herbicides that's actually going through them, and then that's in the manure. Then you try to plant a garden and then you say, oh, my plants died. Well, that's because maybe there's a systemic herbicide still in your potting soil mix that now is affecting your vegetable plants. And this has happened, right? I know people this has happened to, and you read all these horror stories online. So I'm quite cautious about that unless you know the source or you have yourself. Also, you know, straight manures, you know, can burn your plants if you're using too much of them. So that's why, you know, recommend, you know, a plant-based mixture of compost from, you know, vegetable scraps, food scraps, and yard waste predominantly, right? And that's kind of what I do here myself. Let's see here. I would also, you could add some mushroom compost, but mushroom compost, you got to find out what the source of the mushroom compost is and what it is made of, because it's just called mushroom compost, but you don't know what they're adding to it to make the mushroom compost. And some of the stuff could be pretty nasty. Now you're going to plant in half barrels, white half barrels. Around here, the half barrels are just kind of like that oak color or stained or whatever. And yeah, that's fine. Those are really good planters. I grow fruits and vegetables in them, and some trees too. You don't really need to paint them darker. I wouldn't waste your time. Let's see. How deep should a raised bed be? A raised bed, you know, everybody has a different answer on that. So, like, my optimal height for a raised bed is 12 inches deep. You know, I don't think you need to make it any deeper unless you're going to grow globo root or something like really long roots. But you could do less. You know, these beds here are about 8 inches tall. At 8 inches is the minimum I would recommend. I've also got away with doing like 4 to 6 inches, but I just don't think those are quite tall enough. So I'd really minimally do 8, and I really would like to have a 12 inches. That just gives you also a good area maybe to sit on when they're 12 inches tall. You can still squat and sit on it, and it's a nice sitting surface. When it's too low, you still got to bend over too much too also. Let's see, do you have any rattlesnakes? No, we don't have rattlesnakes here. And I have new programs or new videos coming out every 3 to 4 days. So click the subscribe button right down below to be notified of my new videos that are coming out twice a week. All right, next question, long one. Eileen Berg. Hi, John. We love your videos. I have a question. I've never used cannabis in any form. I have several medical issues resulting in chronic pain. I've been on opioids for several years. It appears they have taken a toll on my kidneys, bones, and blood sugar. Plus, they don't work well. I'm considering growing and ingesting cannabis in various ways in place of the opioids. I understand there's one type of cannabis that offers pain relief while helping with energy, which my pain drains from me, and the other type that then helps with pain and sleep. I also take sleeping medication due to my pain interfering with my sleep. So, can you offer me some help from your knowledge? Is cannabis safer than opioids? Do you know if it truly works on pain? Can it truly help my energy levels as well? I am 69 years young. I love to garden, so play with my grandchildren. In other words, live life, but I'm not able to do in my current situation or current condition. I'm not allowed to take aspirin or ibuprofen because of my kidneys. I desperately need an anti-inflammatory. My husband and I are going to be adding yacone and turmeric to our garden this year. We have learned a lot from your videos. I know you're very busy, so any help you can offer is greatly appreciated. God bless you and all that you do, Eileen. All right, Eileen, so I have to give a disclaimer here because I'm not a medical doctor. So I encourage you, if you have a medical condition, all my viewers out there, visit a medical doctor or alternative medical doctor that is licensed and qualified in your state to practice. What I'll be sharing with you guys next is actually my personal opinion. And if I had the conditions that you're explaining and I was in your situation, I'm explaining what I would do if I was in your personal situation, right? So I'm not giving any kind of advice on what you guys should do, but what I would do if I was in your situation, okay? So is cannabis safer than opioids? So based on my research and my experience, I would say it's much more safer than opioids. You know, once we start processing, you know, opioids in the form of drugs, they're concentrating the opioids and or making synthetic opioids that you're taking. And I would much rather take cannabis. You know, I'm sure that opioids may make your pain go away. I mean, the recent story I could give is actually my dad had pancreatitis. So he was hospitalized for pancreatitis. He was in severe pain, probably due to inflammation. They gave him opioids. And to me, the opioids, what it does is it masks the situation. So like if you're driving your car and your check engine light goes on, or maybe your oil light actually, maybe the oil light comes on. The oil light, you guys know, only comes on if your car is low in oil. And actually one day this happened to me, which is a whole nother story. And you don't want to ignore your check oil light, you know, because maybe something happened. And if your car is low on oil, you could seize your engine and your whole car could be shot, right? So, you know, using opioids is like putting a Band-Aid over your check oil light and just keep driving, right? And anyways, the story that happened to me was I was driving on the freeway behind a car, and I was driving, and I hear a large clunk, and then my check oil light came. I'm like, what the heck? I'm like, I just checked the oil before this trip. But I'm like, John, the check oil light came on. You better stop. So I pulled over at the next place, and sure enough, the clunk I heard was a rock hitting my oil pan, and all the oil had drained out. And if I was to continue driving, that car would have been toast. Well, the engine would have been toast anyways. Anyways, I was able to fix the engine, put a new oil pan on, fill it up with oil, and it started right up. And then actually, I sold the car. So opioids just masked the symptoms. And yeah, they gave my dad the opioids, which also gave him other issues, like then he was constipated and whatnot. And that didn't really help the inflammation. It just kind of subverted the problem. And in my belief, you know, a lot of drugs that people are being given these days just mask the problems, and they don't have anything to do with getting down to the root of the cause, right? The root of the cause in the case of my car was, man, I hit a rock and it hit the oil pan and put a hole in it, right? Do you know if it truly works on pain? So, you know, I don't have any major pains in my body, so I've used cannabis, both CBD and the THC varieties of cannabis, and you know, I couldn't really tell you on that. I do know and have a personal friend that actually has you know, pain, and she uses cannabis and it works for her. And I would definitely say that it's worth looking into if it's legal in your state. And can it truly help my energy level as well? You know, I'm not gonna make any claims for what cannabis can or cannot do, but what I will say is this. You know, I will say that when we wake up in the morning, we all have a level of energy. And depending on what you choose to do in your day, you will have more or less energy. If you sleep all day, you might have more energy. You know, if you eat certain foods, you may have more energy. Like, you know, I like to eat high energy foods, foods that are nice and vibrant and alive, things from my garden, fresh fruits and fresh vegetables. You know, those foods give me more energy. And if you're to eat like, you know, candy bars and soda and cookies and chips, processed foods, those are probably gonna take away your energy. You know, especially in the ways I eat my fruits and vegetables, which are usually juiced and or blended, they're very easy to digest because digestion takes a lot of energy. And if you try to eat something that's, you know, pretty hard to digest, such as animal products or meats, that we don't quite have the enzymes and things that break down as efficiently as carnivores do, and we have long digestive tracts, you know, you may have less energy. So I would not say that like cannabis is gonna help your energy. What I would say, and what I would do personally, is I would, you know, make significant and maybe even radical dietary changes to eat more lower on the food chain and eat the foods you're growing and eat more fruits and vegetables. And you know, that's what I've been doing for many years now, and it works for me and it works for many people I know, and it probably would work for you too. And the last thing I'd like to say is that the thing, if I was you, what I would do is I would include more anti-inflammatory foods in my diet. And what are these foods? Well, number one is turmeric. It's great that you're growing it. I would say even besides growing it and having your own before you could even get it done and growing, you know, I would include turmeric like I do myself, include on a daily basis, you know, in your diet. You know, I like to juice it in my juice, and you can't really even taste it when you juice it, and you get a good shot of that stuff. And you could, I'll put a link down below to the video to the Three Sisters Farm. They sell some of the best organic permaculture raised turmeric that I've seen, and they will ship it to you out of Florida. And you could also use the turmeric they sell you to grow your own turmeric and also to eat. So actually I got a big bag of it in my fridge that I got from them when I was visiting, and I'm still using it, and it lasts a long time. So that's really cool. Also, be sure to eat high antioxidant rich foods. You know, in many cases these are also have been shown to be anti-inflammatory. So one of my favorite fruits that's really anti-inflammatory are cactus fruits. And the dark, highly pigmented cactus fruits are really good, and other, you know, dark, deep, pigmented fruits and vegetables have been shown to be anti-inflammatory too, such as purple carrots, right? When you want to eat all these really dark, anthocyanin-rich foods with high pigments, you know, dark bull's blood beets, and just really bone up and eat lots of these high antioxidant foods. And this will, you know, based on my research, and if I had your conditions, you know, this would basically stop the inflammation at a source, so then you don't get the pain. And that's what I would choose to do if it was me. So hope that helps you out. And yeah, keep on living. Next question is from Marietta Gordon. Hello, John. First, I want to say thank you for the awesome and very informative videos. They have really gotten me interested in starting my own raised bed garden. I've also been watching a bunch of your composting videos, and I want to get a tumbling composter. However, I can't afford the Swedish one that you say is your favorite. What would you say is your second favorite? I saw that you said you'd do another video on the reviewing all the composters you currently own. Is that still going to happen? I know you're busy. I just want to be able to produce the best compost I can for what I could actually afford. Thanks again. Sincerely, Margarita. All right, Margarita. Yeah, I mean, I've my compost alley there. It's kind of in a disarray right now, so I wanted to try to get it in order and move some composters around and make it look a little bit nicer before I made a video. And that's on my list. But I just have me and some of those composters are going to take a couple guys to move and set up like I wanted to. But I'm still going to do that video. It's been on the top of my list. I just haven't been able to get to it since I've been having to plant out okra and do other things. So it's kind of like lower on the priority list. But in any case, as you guys know, for the guys that have been watching me a while, the Juraform composter is my number one favorite composter overall. It's insulated. It works faster. It's made out of metal. It's going to last you a long time. And they just work well. I mean, when my other composters aren't working as well, the Juraform, even in the middle of winter when it's like 30 degrees, it's still a hot pile in there, man, and still working to break this down stuff, breaking the stuff down as fast as possible so I could actually get the compost out and put it back in my garden instead of just having it sit there being uncomposted, right? That being said, I will say my second favorite brand is the Lifetime brand tumbling composters. And which one you get is critical, because some of them are junk and some of them are better than others. I like their large, I think it's like an 80 gallon tumbler composter. I'll put a link down below to the video where actually I built it. That's probably my favorite one overall because it's pretty durable. I did have some issues with that at one point, but it snapped back and it's still working good. Probably my second favorite one is the dual barrel composter. I'll put a link down below to that video. And that is available at Costco right now near you, more than likely. about $150, and that thing is huge. There's two sides, so you have one side to fill up, and when you're done filling that side up, then you go to the other side to fill up, and you still spin the first side, and by the time you're done spinning the first side and filling the second side, your first side should be done, then you can take that stuff out and keep rotating. So I think that's probably one of the best composters to make. I did have issues with it actually falling apart and all my compost coming out, and then Lifetime Products has excessively poor customer support. I did email them, they didn't respond, then all of a sudden I get an email like 3 months later, hey, we're gonna close out your claim about a warranty support because blah blah blah, and like that's the first I've ever heard of them. So maybe they're trying, maybe they're gonna get better, maybe I need to just call them up instead of emailing them. I'm gonna try that one of these days, because actually another one of my Lifetime composters is still having some issues I need some parts for. Alright, hope that helps you out there. Omega 200K. Hi John, love your videos and I've watched many of them as I tend to learn more from your videos. I've also incorporated more leafy greens. I noticed on Dr. John McDougall's website the link of heavy metals in cruciferous vegetables, mainly kale, broccoli, collard greens, etc. Is this true, as I'm unable to find hardly little to none information on this other than Dr. McDougall's article and a link to non-scientific website. What are your thoughts on this? All right, Omega 2000 or 200K, here are my thoughts. So, plants absorb minerals. I mean, we will all agree on that. And depending on what minerals you feed it, is gonna be what minerals are in it. So for example, if you feed NPK, you know, synthetic minerals in there, that's what they're going to absorb in, and they're going to have, you know, different balances. And I'll have a video upcoming on this and how really conventionally grown food with NPK synthetic fertilizers are really kind of off balance and really is not what nature really wants us to eat. It's what agro business wants us to eat because they get better and higher yields and it's easy. So, and also based on what's in the soil is what the plant will absorb. Now, one of the things many synthetic fertilizer companies don't tell you is that they are allowed to put in and basically get rid of heavy metals or, you know, toxic metals in the fertilizers. So if you are buying conventional produce, it may be being grown with things like biosolids, which may have heavy metals, or with fertilizers that may have heavy metals, and then now that's in the plants. So now when they do testing on those plants, it has heavy metals because plants are bioaccumulators. If there's a lot of a mineral in the soil and it's a certain kind of plant, it'll take it up. Certain plants absorb certain minerals better than others. And I'm not the expert on which plant takes up zinc better or this better or that better, you know. So yes, this is totally plausible, totally true. And it depends on what's in the soil and how they're being grown. Now, I don't know how the kale were being grown in Dr. McDougall's non-scientific website or anything, but I do know that, you know, soils are polluted and that there's been some cases in California where these ladies who eat kale every day, organic kale, mind you, you know, had excessive amounts of certain heavy metals in their body and it causes health challenges, even though they're trying to do the right thing because kale's so healthy, right? So what do we do? Do we just say, oh man, I'm just going to start eating meat and not eat any kale because there's heavy metals in kale? Well, then you got further problems because, you know, the earth is polluted these days, and especially if the animals or cows or whatever you're eating are eating, you know, GMO corn or soy, those are being grown with synthetic fertilizers, also heavy metals. And even worse, animals bioaccumulate heavy metal toxins more than the plants. So, yeah, we want to eat lower on the food chain to minimize the risk, right? And so my thoughts are, grow your own plants in good, clean, you know, soil, as clean as you could get it, you know, using compost from organic materials that are not a product of the industrial agriculture system, that are using the NPK fertilizers that have toxic heavy metals and or biosolids, and then grow your plants, you adding things like rock dust and the beneficial minerals. And yes, even rock dust has some trace or, you know, heavy metals in there, but they're in low concentrations. And also, this is super critical, a lot of people that talk about this topic miss, is we want to get the microbiology and the beneficial bacteria and fungi in the soil, because they break these things down, right? They break these things down. So we want to have a good mixture, like I teach, of trace minerals and microbiology, some good soil that's not contaminated, and then I believe everything's going to be right. Now, that being said, just because you do that, still every plant absorbs certain minerals more than others. So even if you, and then you could get your soil tested if you're crazy about it. You know, I don't go that far. One of these days I'll get my soil tested for all the heavy trace mineral contamination. But I just like to let nature work itself out, right? And the other thing I do that's very important is, as you guys could see behind me, I don't just have, you know, 10 beds of kale growing, right? I have kale, I have collards, I have arugula, I have tomatoes, I have okra. I have many different things growing. I have, you know, these guys right here, you guys might see the goji berries, and I have longevity spinach. You guys probably can't see it, it's out of the shot there. And I have tree collards over on this side. I have many different plants, and I don't just eat all kale. I eat a little bit of every plant, because every plant will bioaccumulate toxic heavy metals and also beneficial trace minerals our body needs to function optimally. And so I eat a little bit of everything, even if it's, okay, I'm eating kale today, and then I'll eat, you know, the genera procumbens or longevity spinach the next day, then I'm going to eat some arugula the next day, then I'm going to eat the lettuce the next day. And I'm always rotating through all the different things I'm eating, so I'm never eating, you know, any one plant that could get a high concentration of minerals, because every plant absorbs different minerals at different levels, even if you're using the same soil. So I hope that answered your question. That's kind of my ideas on that, and yeah, and especially, yeah, get away from buying toxic conventional food. Even organic food may be contaminated with trace, you know, heavy metals. And so yet another reason to grow your own, right? And do the best you can. That's very important. All right, next question is from Porch Cricket. I need some advice growing perennial greens, brassicas. I normally grow organic fruit trees and vines and tomatoes using AACT in raised beds. I live in hot, dry, low chill northeast Los Angeles on a hilltop, sunset 21, USDA 10, with 100 to 350 chill hours. From a private grower northeast of San Diego, Temecula, wine country, I bought 2 purple tree collards, red boar kale, lacinato kale. Here are my questions. Where should I plant them? Full sun, morning sun, filtered afternoon, always filtered light. I could make a bed on the east side of the wisteria, which would be naked in the winter and filtered in the afternoon, spring, summer, or fall. Or I could squeeze them in between espalier along the side of the house. How many hours of light do you think they need? Did your tree collards do better singly or in a dense bed? Are there other perennial greens or summer greens from my area that you could suggest? I was looking at some of these, but they are north of San Francisco and not my climate, and they reference a link at bountifulgardens.org/department/294. All right, so you got a number of questions in there. So let's see. Number one, you have several different plants, so I'm going to give different recommendations based on my experience growing these in a desert dry climate. That's like a 9A. And also I grew them in 9B, so not quite 10, USDA 10. But basically, I've grown the tree collards in basically full sun. I've also grown them in part shade. And depending on how hot it gets and where you are, you know, you could do both, you know. And I would recommend, since you got, you know, maybe a couple of each, I would recommend planting them in different areas, right? One area may do better for you than others, because there's also a lot of different microclimates. I kind of like the area you had with the Wiseria, you know, where you're going to get, you know, full sun in the winter, which would be good, or naked in the winter, and then filtered in the afternoons in the spring and summer. You know, for me, my tree collards get actually quite hot and spicy and almost to the point where I don't want to eat them in the summer, because they create extra phytonutrients or something, or plant metabolites in there to protect themselves from the sun, which is not desirable for me to eat, although they're probably more highly anti-cancerous in the summer than in the winter due to these compounds. But they taste a lot sweeter in the winter, right? So yeah, plant them in both, and then plant one there, and then maybe plant one more in full sun, and see what happens, right? And once you get them growing, right, you could take cuttings and propagate them, and then plant them around your area in other places. And I like to space them out at least like 2-3 feet in between if you have a lot of acreage or space. I've done them as close as a foot. It's getting kind of tight. But yeah, they'll do fine. You know, they're pretty easy plants. Now, as to the other kinds of kale, the red boar, that I would definitely not really, you know, my experience growing the red boar in the summer, they bolt really fast. So that I would definitely put in a more shadier, cool spot if you're trying to grow it in the summer. And the lacinato, I have that in full sun. It's probably one of the sunniest spots in my garden, and it just takes it. So I'd put that in a full sun position and grow that straight through the summer, that'll be great. Last question is having to do with perennial greens. So I'll put a link to a video down below I made in the desert and in the hot desert where I have certain greens that grow really well. So the greens that I would recommend you grow in the summertime in your situation are, number one, these guys. We'll see if you could lean it over. You could see them a little bit. This is known as the Gynera procumbens or longevity spinach. This is probably going to survive for you year-round in a zone 10, potentially, although you may want to cover them to be sure. Also, I would recommend the Egyptian spinach, another excellent green that's going to easily take the heat and is quite delicious. Another one I would recommend is my favorite Ashitaba. That is another green I like to eat. It can be a little more stronger tasting depending on your specific climate. Another one I like to eat is the Malabar spinach. They got the red stem and the green stem Malabar spinach. That's another no-brainer that's going to do really well and grow easy for you in your climate zone. Another one also is called Katuk. It will grow easily in the summer in the heat. That's going to be hard to get. Or Soropus androgynous, I believe. And then another one I would recommend, I think I said Okinawan spinach is another one that I'd recommend. Oh, and also depending on where you live, you know, Moringa, another really good one. And also, if you cook your greens, you could get a chaya tree and also a baleay tree or hibiscus manuhut. Probably pronouncing that wrong. But those are all good ones to try and get you started on some good perennial greens to grow. All right. Or perennial greens slash summer greens that can handle the heat. All right. We're down to the last two questions. User Namil. Hey, John, my crops have taken some damage from the frost here in New Jersey. Should I dig up the damaged plants and reseed, or should I let them try and become a healthy-looking plant again? Thanks for everything. So that depends on what plants they are. So, like, for example, if I'm growing lettuce or something in my winter garden, and then we get a frost and then freezes, and then, like, you know, I'll go out in the middle of the night and, like, my lettuce plants are, like, frozen solid, you know, I'll let them thaw out and then recover. So plants that are winter plants that are used to being, you know, used to the cold, I'll let them totally recover. You know, they'll lose their outer leaves. I'll probably pluck off some of the outer leaves and let them thaw out and recover, and they'll be fine. Same thing with some of my brassica family plants, collard, kale, and other things that are more hardy. Now, those I would let recover for sure. Now, if you're trying to plant out summer crops early, and in New Jersey, I probably wouldn't recommend it. I would say start over, right? Once a summer crop that doesn't have a frost tolerance gets damaged, they're really hard for those guys to recover. And it's kind of like if you got a, this is a bad example, and I hate giving bad examples, but if you got a baby and it's abused as a baby, you know, the chances are it's not going to be as maybe as normal as it should be when it's an adult, and it's going to have a hard time recovering, right? Or God forbid, an abused child or something like that, right? So, yeah, I would just cut your losses and start over, right? And sorry about the bad analogies. All right, last question is from D. Pulleys GR. I have a 4 foot by 4 foot raised bed just starting to plant peppers, tomatoes, and cucumbers 2 weeks ago. I've already seen a lot of growth, but what can I do to maintain the nutrients in my soil when I already have plants growing in my garden? So what I would recommend for adding nutrients to your soil, and I don't know, hopefully you use like a Mel's mix, compost, coconut coir, and vermiculite, or some other kind of good mix to fill your raised bed. And mineral, if you didn't do that, if you already had been growing in there or you inherited the raised bed, I always encourage everybody to top off their raised bed after every growing season with a new mixture of things like compost and rock dust and worm castings and insect frass. I use some John and Bob's products. I probably have posted already a video that I'll put down below where I go over what I add to my raised bed before I plant out. But if you already planted things out, then, you know, you could always water in some like rock dust in there or scratch it in on the sides, top dress. You could top dress in some organic fertilizer such as the John and Bob's products. I mean, I would probably basically just make a good compost tea, like a Boogie Brew compost tea, and then spray that on a weekly basis, which would probably be good because, you know, the soil that you're growing in the raised bed, unless you live somewhere where you're growing in sand, which I actually don't recommend, it's got organic matter in there. The problem is the organic matter needs to be broken down by the biology or the beneficial microbes and microbiome to make those locked up nutrients available to be uptaken by the plants. So that'd be another really good thing to do. Another thing I do is also I will actually use like things like kelp. I'll like water in like water-soluble kelp, mix in water that on my plants or other kind of kelp solutions. Or maybe if my plants are kind of yellowing and having a hard time adjusting, then I'll use some fish hydrolysate, such as the pure protein that is available at boogiebrew.net/GYG, as is the compost tea. So yeah, that's what I'd kind of do. Hope that helps you guys out. If you guys enjoyed this Q&A session, hey, please give me a thumbs up to let me know. I'll be sure to do more Q&As in the future. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below to be notified of my new and upcoming episodes I have coming out about every 3 to 4 days. And be sure to check my past episodes. They contain a wealth of knowledge, over 1,100 episodes at this point, nearing 1,200 episodes, actually. And yeah, I would encourage you guys, you know, gardening is just a learning experience, and look at it like that. You know, there's no failures, there's only successes, because if you do fail, you succeeded in learning how not to do something, right? And just learn as you grow, that's what I like to say. In any case, this is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing. All right, this is John Kohler with GrowingYourGreens.com. Through another exciting episode for you. And if I could keep my cat contained for any length of time, Mega Cat will be in the video also. This is my kitty.